What's up, Grio fam? My name is Stephen London, director of video here at thegrio.com. And today I am joined by chef, author, artist, and my good friend, Lazarus Lynch, son of a Southern chef. If you haven't tried any of his recipes or listened to any of his music, then honey, you are late because this is where it's at. First of all, we need to talk about the music because people know you for making delicious, yummy things. I know as for myself, you've made some stuff that I've tried that I've been like, oh my God, this is so good. And of course, putting, you know, this healthy, new, innovative way to some of our favorite traditional Southern dishes. But now you're stepping into music and you have some really, really good stuff that I've been watching and seeing. So tell me a little bit more about what kind of that experience was like for you diving into that and what can we expect?
Yeah, you know, I think music has always been a part of me. It's been part of my foundation. Stephen, when you and I met, because we went to school together, we went to college together, and I was very active in the gospel choir on campus. I don't know if you remember that. Yeah. So music has always been another way for me to express, you know, who I am. I grew up singing in church a lot and leading songs and just being in front of people and singing, and food was always a part of that. But it wasn't until I think 2016 that I really started to pay attention to the musical side of me. I started getting ideas for songs and meeting artists left and right, and just ended up one day at a little, you know, like a little, what do you call it? I ended up one day at this like little gig, and there were a bunch of people there, and they invited me to like a house party for musicians and producers. And I got there and I just made all these connections. And then I met friends who were like, come over my studio and let's make some music. And I just started making music. So since 2016, I started putting out songs. My first song was In My World. And I put it out having no idea like what it means to put music out and like what streaming is all about. And literally within like months, it shot up to like 300,000 plays on Spotify, which now I understand is like a big deal. But at the time I was just like, I don't know what that even means. And like, I don't even know how that works. But that was a real sign from the universe for me that I was meant to do this, because it was such an affirming kind of and validating kind of response that I just thought, wow, I can keep doing this. So I just continued putting music out. So earlier, in 2019, I put out my second song called I'm Gay. And that was my, here I am, y'all, this is me in a 3-minute song.
I've arrived. Okay.
I've arrived. And it just really hit a zeitgeist for people. I mean, it for me was a very like, here I am and I'm unashamed. But in the song, I really talked about my upbringing in church. You know, I talk about the shame that I felt. I talked about you know, just kind of, will this ever go away? And by the end of the song, I'm just like, I'm so free just being myself. Like, I'm so free being myself. So I think my music has become affirming for me. It's become a space that I go to kind of usher myself into my higher power. And I think that's what it's done for people who listen to it. They feel seen, they feel loved, they feel stronger and proud to be who they are. So the music that I got coming out this year is definitely going to speak to that.
There's a special interaction and intersection that happens with Black and LGBTQ, right? We're celebrating Black and Proud this month here at the GRIO, whether that's being Black and gay, whether it's being Black in music, right? What do we look like in Music Month? And I think in your particular experience, not only through being a chef, but also music, you have always been very vocal in celebrating both sides of your identity. Obviously, with that intersection, there's also some trauma there that our community, specifically the Southern church, that world still has with LGBTQ. Have you experienced any backlash at all? Or like, do you ever go into something being worried about how I had this one particular audience that loves my food, that loves the music or things that I make, but here's this other side of my identity that's just as important and it's so vocal and so open. Do you think that there's ever like thoughts or muddling there that's happening?
You know, Stephen, when I first dropped my single, I'm Gay, back in June 2020, I actually dropped it on Juneteenth 2020. I got calls immediately, almost immediately, from people who I knew from church days who followed me on Facebook, people who were not necessarily engaged in my everyday life, but that just kind of knew about me or knew me or had access to me. And they called me and they were just like, so what did this mean? They were like, so are you coming out? And it was such an interesting response. Right. So, you know, at one point I had to stop answering the calls because I wasn't sure if people were calling to congratulate me or condemn me or just be curious. And so what I learned through that experience was that it takes courage to show up in your truth. And when you show up in your truth, oftentimes you're going to have someone question you, you know, but you have to know that you're free in being who you are. And so now the kind of responses that I get are from people who had similar backgrounds to me, who had the religious trauma, who had the emotional abuse and trauma, who just struggled with identity. I got a call from a person last night just through Instagram messages who was telling me that she's really struggling and she's sort of in the closet and doesn't know how to kind of come out. And she has all these Christian friends who she still loves and adores. And I totally, totally understand that. But what I said to her, and I'm going to say it here, is that you have to know that God does not condemn you, that God loves you. And if you believe in God, if you believe in the universe or whatever, that you're going to be supported. And I can tell you that ever since I own my own truth, it's not even about coming out to the world. It's about you living in the center of your truth every single day. I've woken up with peace, with joy. There's been like an abundance of blessings that have fallen into my life. And I don't think that that's just because I work hard. I think it's because I work hard, but I'm also living truthfully. I'm living from the truth of who I am. So yeah, and I think that's also like within the church spaces, you know, I'm seeing there's a lot of reconciliation happening. There's a lot of growth happening. There's a lot of theological correction that's happening right now. And people understand that you can still have a relationship with God. You can have a call of a certain religion and be truthful in your identity.
It even bothers me, the idea of coming out, because it's like, straight people don't have to come out. Heterosexuals don't come out and be like, hey, by the way, you guys, I'm straight. I like women, or I like, you know, like they don't have to do that.
Right.
So it almost seems, you know, like there's this pressure that we not only have to be ourselves and out loud and deal with the criticism and the lack of knowledge, if you will, but also are expected to have to make these things public and be so open about it. Which leads me to my next question, especially when it comes to your platform in cooking, because son of a Southern chef, how do you think that cuisine and that culture is growing with you as you continue to find yourself more and live more in your truth?
There's a really great documentary that a few of my friends are in that just came out on Netflix called High on the Hog. And it's based on the book by Jessica B. Harris, who's a food historian and writer and professor and just extraordinary woman, Black woman. You know, within that piece, and I'm still processing the piece, but within that, they kind of talk about, you know, the pilgrimage from Africa to the Western world and carrying all those ingredients with them and carrying culture with them and pushing culture forward with the food that they brought over, the ingredients that they brought over. And I think for me, there's a very specific connection between who I am as a Black queer man and who I am as also the descendant of a Southern family, and also, you know, the child of an immigrant mother. And I think that what happens and what has happened along the way with migration and folks moving from place to place and being displaced, that there is a natural trauma that is inherent within that experience of moving from place to place. My mother got up from Guyana when she was 13 and moved with her family to London, and then from London to New York when she was 26. So this idea of never really being settled, my father's side from slavery, enslavement to, you know, not even making it off the ships, some of them, because they just died because the experience was so gruesome. And I think, you know, when I look back at my own history and I look back at what has endured, food has been the testimony that has endured. It's been the recipe, the songbook, as I say, the lyric from the songbook of my ancestors. That's what recipes are. And those things live on and they tell us who we are. And so for me, I think the more I've gotten aware of my identity as a Black and queer man, and the more I've grown proud into that, the more I've actually connected with the food of my people, because I understand that that food has crossed through so many generations. It's crossed through so many hands, so many lands to get to me. And so food is not just a right, and it's not just a privilege, it's a right, it's a human right. We all deserve that. And so is walking in the truth of who we are. That is our innate born right. And so I think that there's a really strong connection there. I'm really interested, I think, in the next iteration of my food career of really bridging that gap, specifically going into the South and, you know, amplifying that it's okay to be LGBTQ+, you know, and it's okay to live in your truth. And it's also okay to love your traditions and love your family and love where you come from. I think what I've been able to do is sort of appreciate the things that work within my culture, and then the things that don't serve me, to with grace and with gratitude say, no, thank you. And I think there's space for that.
You have a single coming out as well, and you have an album dropping in July.
It's crazy. It's true.
What are you talking about? Like, can I get tickets to the tour that's coming next year? Like, what?
Something. I mean, I'm, you know, this is so new for me, Stephen. You know, even with the book, like having a book tour was so new for me. And there was a ton of people working on that. I'm very, very proud. The single is called Black Queer Anthem. And I feel like I've been in this space lately where I've been composing songs that just are anthemic. You know, they just feel like anthems. And this is just, yeah, I kind of was walking around the house and I just kind of heard it in my head. And I felt like I was at a protest while I was singing this song. And then I just went to my computer and recorded it in one take. And that's what's coming out. So that's coming out June 18th. I'm so excited. Please, y'all, please. If you're Black and you're queer, or if you know Black and queer people, like, just send it to folks, because I really believe, like, it's going to be a song that really celebrates who we are. It's really a joyful, powerful song. My album is called Sanctuary, and I've been working on this album for 2 years. It's kind of crazy. I didn't know I was working on an album at the time. I just started writing music, and I had a collection of songs, and little by little just started working on each of the songs. And then I started to realize that there was a thread, you know, happening between all of the lyrics. And it kept coming back to this idea that you can love who you are, you can be who you are, you can have a relationship with God or higher power or whatever you call it, and you can live your life truthfully. And so I really wanted to, I think the sound of the album kind of has some influence of gospel, jazz, R&B, hip hop, trap. It's kind of a meeting of all of these worlds that I grew up in musically, but it keeps coming back to this idea that your life can be whatever you want it to be. It's in your hands. So I'm very excited to put that out. Yeah.
That's beautiful. And everybody needs to get this. If you're watching this right now, please make sure to check out both of these releases, Black Queer Anthem coming out June 18th, and Sanctuary coming in July. You guys have to support and get into all of this Black queer magic that's happening with Lazarus. Is there anything else that you think we should encourage Black people right now, with it being Pride Month? Is there any call to action or something that you would like to see from the Black community to in support of the queer community?
I want to say two things to the Black community. One is that around queer identity, LGBTQIA+ identity, is to really do a little bit of homework to know how you best can support and be there for your brothers and your sisters. You know, we know that there is the external oppressions that come from the outside world, but it's a really unique oppression to be oppressed by your own. And so one of the things that I think we can all do better is to lift each other up in this month And to make that an ongoing practice, you know, care about your trans brothers and sisters who are Black, care about your, you know, intersection or all the different identities across the spectrum, care and care to learn. I think it's problematic to say that Black lives matter on one hand, and then treat some Black lives like they don't matter on the other hand. Right. So I wanna encourage us all to just show up better, to be there for each other. And the second thing I wanna say is to take care of our mental health. We have to prioritize our mental health. We have to prioritize taking breaks, taking rest, and making space for that. So I just wanna say, sip on some lemonade, sip on some Kool-Aid, take care of yourself, you know, but let's be there for each other, let's support each other, and let's learn together. That's how we're gonna grow.